Society at the university, and I'm proud to introduce Maryam Namazie, who is a writer, broadcaster, human rights activist, a spokesperson for One Vote for All, and a number of other organizations, and she'll be speaking under the title of Apostasy, Blasphemy, and Free Expression in the Age of ISIS. The way that we'll do questions at the end will be I'll come up and I'll point to anybody who wants to ask a question, and then without further ado,
Thank you very much. It's really a great pleasure to be here. I'm really glad to see you. I don't know, can I sit down, you think? I'm so lazy. But then, no, you won't be able to see me. I'm getting old. Okay. I'm really very, very pleased to be here. Thank you so much to the Atheist Society for inviting me. I'm really grateful for that. As you might have heard, I had been barred recently from Warwick University. The student union there barred me because they said that I could possibly incite hatred against Muslim students, and also that I was highly inflammatory. And the same thing happened at Trinity College Dublin. Of course, last month I got to speak at both universities. And of course, today I saw the ISOC here had raised concerns that my speaking here would violate their safe spaces, which I actually find quite funny, because if anyone needs a safe space, it is ex-Muslims and those of us who are facing threats and intimidation as a result of leaving Islam. Now, for me, I think these are very serious accusations, and I think it's a problematic accusation because it's based on the conflation of criticism of Islam, which is a belief, and criticism of Islamism, which is a religious right movement, versus, of course, bigotry against Muslims, who are people like anybody else. And I think what's happened is this conflation between an idea, a far-right political movement, and people has led to a disturbing trend in censorship on university campuses of much-needed criticism of Islam and Islamism. The days, unfortunately, of unconditional free expression, which was championed at universities as a cornerstone of free expression, and as a cornerstone of all rights, is now long gone. And it's no longer unconditional free expression that seemed to be intrinsically good, but a defense of censorship as well as self-censorship. Of course, as the writer Kenan Malik says, no one puts it that way. No one says that they're pro-censorship, not even the worst regimes. But he does go on to say that I believe in free speech, but this may well be the motto of our times. I believe in free speech, but not if it undermines security, not if it's gratuitously offensive, if it's provocative, inflammatory, Islamophobic, discriminatory, or if it has the potential to insult and hurt religious sensibilities or incite hatred, all things which I have been wrongly accused of, in my opinion. In particular, criticism of Islam and Islamism is seen to be so harmful as to be equated with bigotry against Muslims. Though, of course, this isn't the case in the same way that criticizing Britain First or the EDL or criticizing Christianity is not the same thing as bigotry against Christians. Postmodernists such as the Guardian's David Shariat Madari consider criticism of Islam so antisocial that it's even dangerous. Something, by the way, that his Ayatollah friends in Iran also say, as do the Saudi regime or the Pakistani government. In my opinion, criticism of Islam is deemed dangerous not because of some patronizing concern for minorities, but because in the age of ISIS, it subverts and challenges the sacred, which has always been a tool for the control of society in the interests of a dominant class under the guise of defending public sensibilities or morality. Criticism of Islam challenges religion and political power and opens the space for dissent where none is permissible.
Oh, sorry.
Ironically, critics of religion like myself have never been free to express themselves. Are you okay?
I'm fine.
Yeah? Good. Don't want you getting hurt here. There are some seats around. You can sit there. Go ahead, take a seat. I'll wait for you guys.
Come here.
No, you stay over there, bro. You come here.
Welcome to see you.
Sorry.
You don't have to apologize.
I'm not apologizing.
Excuse me?
There's no seats. Ironically, critics of religion, as can be seen, like myself, have never been free to express themselves. Yet we're the ones who are deemed harmful and inciting hatred, when in fact, it's the opposite. It's the blasphemers and apostates who have faced persecution throughout the ages. Clerics and the religious right wing have always been free to promote religion, any religion. And religion has always had a privileged position in societies, and even more so where it has influence in the state or is in power, Britain included. Clearly, freedom of expression without the right to criticize religion is meaningless. Such criticism has been key for social progress. Historically, it's been intrinsically linked with anti-clericalism, and it's the same today. This is a drawing by a hijabi Egyptian cartoonist, Douala Ag, who is opposed to Islamist and extremism and thinks that women's rights and equality are more important than the religious right. Criticism of Islam and the state are analogous in many places, like Saudi Arabia, like the Islamic State or Iran, where anything from demanding women's equality or trade union rights or condemning sexual jihad and the so-called Islamic Cultural Revolution in a place like Iran, where they purged universities and banned books or purified higher education, these can be met often with arrest, imprisonment, and even the death penalty. Of course, there's a distinction between Islam as a belief versus Islamism, which is a far-right political movement. I think some of the ISOC members will know what I mean by Islamism as a far-right
political movement.
The right to religion is not just a personal belief in this day and age. It plays a political role in the form of laws and policies, and as states and extreme right-wing political movements. When the religious right are in power, religion is at the center of the struggle for change, as the Iranian Marxist Tami Takwai has said. So if you want to defend equality between women and men, or you want to end male guardianship rules, for example, which is the rule where women cannot travel without the permission of a male guardian, you will inevitably come face to face with religion. If you want gay rights, if you want the right to organize 1st of May rallies, or the right to strike, you will eventually confront religion. Religion, unfortunately, is not just a personal matter between a believer and his or her God, but it's regulations imposed on society with real and brutal punishments and repercussions for those who are deemed transgressors. The veil, for example, is far from a personal choice and right. Socially speaking, on a mass scale, it's enforced through compulsory veiling laws, acid attacks, imprisonment, fines, as well as pressures which look upon unveiled women as whores, immoral, and sources of fitna in society. This is a great example. It's a billboard in Iran which says that your hijab is your protection, and it compares unveiled women to an unwrapped sweet that is being covered by flies. Now, clearly, this is not something that's only relevant to women living in the Middle East or North Africa and so on, because even, for example, in Britain, calling women who are not properly veiled, calling them hijabis, are very much part of that pressure that women are facing. under such circumstances, criticism of religion is key for the defense of rights and equality. It's also a critical necessity in order to dismantle and undermine the sacred and its political role. And it's not just about religion's role over there. After all, Islamism is a vast global network with huge reach across the world. To give you an example, you've got the Islamic regime of Iran sentencing an artist, Atena Farahdani, to 12 years in prison for a cartoon and for illegitimate sexual relations short of adultery merely because she shook hands with her lawyer. And it violated the gender segregation rules in Iran. And of course, here in Britain, you also have Universities UK, which is a regulatory body for universities, endorsing gender segregation. Of course, that's now been withdrawn as a result of protests. And student organizers advising women not to shake hands with Islamist speakers because it offends their culture. Which, of course, I find quite offensive, that as a woman, a man cannot shake my hands. Islamism as a political movement is a global killing machine. That's exactly what it is. That affects people's lives everywhere. Islamists will hack beloved Bangladeshi bloggers to death in Bangladesh, whilst placing Bangladeshi bloggers who are based in the UK on an international death list. And of course, lovely British jihadis.
Questions at the end, please.
British jihadis. Is it really funny that people get hacked to death?
It's really funny, but
yeah, it is. I know. Silly. I know it's funny for you. But also, you've got
again,
lovely
please,
British jihadis killing beautiful boys like Mohammed and Wazi, killing for ISIS, while UK-based organisation Cage Prisoners promotes defensive jihad. Limiting free expression to that which is acceptable to ISOCs and Islamists is basically limiting expression to what is deemed acceptable by those who have power. And it restricts the rights for people to speak who need it most.
Stop
it's telling people like myself
the entire event.
Be quiet or get out. Be quiet or get out. I am speaking. Be quiet or get out. 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 If you want to speak, go outside. Be quiet or get out. Be quiet or get out. Don't worry. Be quiet or get out.
You will stop the speech three times.
Be quiet or get out. Be quiet and get out.
Please stop speaking
be
while Maryam
quiet.
Is having her speak.
Be
you can
quiet.
Ask questions at the end.
Do not
quiet.
No.
Be quiet. I'm trying to say.
You're intimidating me.
You're intimidating me. Go to your safe space.
If you're going
to
keep interrupting, then please just leave.
In the white shot. The white shot.
Yes, you're allowed to be here. I'm not going to be asking you. You're fine, but then please quiet down.
Be quiet or let me speak.
Intimidation.
Can you stop interrupting me?
Not to you, right?
What are you talking
about? It's telling people like myself who have fled theocracies and religious laws that people who have fled them or who are living under the boot of the religious right must face segregation and Sharia courts right here in Britain. We cannot refuse and resist. It's our culture and religion after all. We have no choice but to submit to our fascists.
Safe space.
Ironically, the postmodernist leftists who are pushing the line have one set of progressive
Safe
politics
face.
For themselves. They're writing one day marriage, women's equality, and the right to criticize the Archbishop, and another for us.
Safe space.
We're merely allowed to make demands within the confines of Islam and identity politics. As an ex-Muslim woman, I am supposedly a minority within a minority, but the power imbalance never seems to be part of any equation. If we speak, we are labeled native informants, and the far right accuses us of practicing taqiyya if we oppose the scapegoating of Muslims and immigrants. I've also been accused of practicing taqiyya by far right groups like
He just told me to shut the fuck up.
Don't tell me to sit down.
This person is telling us to shut the fuck up. He's telling us to shut the fuck up.
Did anyone hear that? Well, I didn't know about your comment.
You can.
Yeah, it's okay. Bye bye. Can you get out?
Anti-Semitic, and of course,
anti-free expression. That is the stereotype of the authentic Muslim.
And anti-Semitism started in Europe.
Here's a photo of in Iran, veiling is compulsory. Here is a photo of a woman who has taken an unveiled photo of herself saying, in front of a placard that says, "Sisters, respect your Islamic hijab." So the point is that there is resistance and dissent even amongst Muslims, even in countries that are considered Muslim majority. As Algerian sociologist Maryam Namazie says, what is most upsetting is the implication that oppressed people can only turn out as fascists, never revolutionaries. Is this really what the left in Europe now believes? She asks, can the left really accept that citizens are assigned minority identity against their will on the basis of their name or their geographical origin or that of their families? Can the left accept that this communal identity supersedes civil rights? This was done to the Jews under Nazism. Will the left accept that it be done to Muslims or those presumed to be Muslims, regardless of their personal religious beliefs? If the left is serious about supporting oppressed minorities, it should realize that those who speak in the name of the community do not necessarily have the legitimacy to do so. By supporting fundamentalists, they simply choose one camp in a political struggle without acknowledging it. The result of all this, as Kenan Malik says, the writer, is that solidarity has become increasingly defined, not in political terms, as collective action in pursuit of certain political ideals, but in terms of ethnicity or culture. And since those in power determine the dominant culture, many student unions, those on the left, and even feminists, side with Islamism at our expense. They don't see that at its core, this is a fight between theocrats and the religious right on the one hand, and secularists and those fighting for social justice on the other. It's a fight taking place within and across communities and borders, including and especially amongst that those within which is labeled the Muslim community or world. Take the example of 27-year-old Farhunde. She was accused by a mullah of being an infidel who burned verses of the Quran. She was attacked by a mob in Kabul, lynched, stoned, run over, burnt, and her body thrown in a river whilst onlookers and police watched. What could she expect, said one liberal to bitter, when she went against Muslim sensibilities in this way? But actually, Farhunde was a very devout Muslim and had gone to the local mullah to tell him to stop selling amulets to women. What became very obvious after Farhunde's murder was that not all Afghans, not all Muslims, and not all Muslim men have the same sensibilities. Women carried her body, going against Islamic customs with the permission of her family, to her gravesite, and encircled her coffin, there were men who were surrounding them to protect them. And when a mullah who had justified Farhunde's murder tried to join them after he saw that there was all these protests in her defense, the women created a circle around her coffin and refused to allow him entry, and they forced him to leave the gravesite. Azaryun, who's a youth activist, she said, this is what Farhunde teaches me. Together, we can change the narrative that others write about women. We stood up against the most respected mullah. We carried the coffin and we buried her. Niyaya, she's a medical student, said, it was the first time that I realized my real power and told myself that I am breaking the boundaries of tradition. So the people of Afghanistan do not all agree. Muslims are not all the same. And I place Muslims in quotes because not everyone living in Iran or Afghanistan are Muslims or Islamists, just like not everyone living in Britain is Christian or the EDL. Again, this is from a protest in Afghanistan against the stoning of 19-year-old Rokhshana. everywhere, from Iran to Afghanistan to Algeria, there are women and men who break taboos and change narratives and stand against religion's encroachment in people's lives and against Islamism. Charlie Hebdo is another good example. 145 writers opposed Penn's award to Charlie because they said it was valorizing offensive material that intensified anti-Islamic, anti-Maghreb, anti-Arab sentiments that are prevalent in the Western world. But as Salman Rushdie said, the Charlie Hebdo artists were executed in cold blood for drawing cartoons, which is an entirely legitimate activity. It is quite right that Penn should honor their sacrifice and condemn their murder. This issue, he says, has nothing to do with an oppressed and disadvantaged minority. It has everything to do with the battle against fanatical Islam, which is highly organized, well-funded, and which seeks to terrify us all, Muslims as well as non-Muslims, into cowed silence. And a lot of people, including Muslims, agree. Mustafa Urad, he's a native Algerian and copy editor for Charlie, who was killed in the attack. A French Muslim cafe owner was threatened for putting Je suis Charlie sign in his East London coffee shop. In Turkey, two columnists from a daily are facing an investigation for religious defamation after featuring the Charlie cover. And cartoonists across the Arab world, from Egypt to Lebanon to Qatar and to Jordan, took a stand with Charlie against the Islamists. Even in Iran, which is a theocracy, where blasphemy, apostasy, enmity against God, heresy, and 130 offenses are punishable by death, you have someone like Nasrin Sotoudeh, who's a human rights lawyer, showing her solidarity with Charlie. Whilst journalists who tried to rally in support of Charlie were attacked and prevented from protesting by security agents wielding clubs and chains. An Iranian newspaper was shut down for publishing a photo showing Charlie, solidarity with Charlie. So clearly, not all Muslims are offended, and even those who are do not go on to kill for it. In Bangladesh too, there are Islamists killing and threatening beloved atheist bloggers like Abhijit Roy, but there is also a deeply secular movement against them, including 24 villages that have become known as Jama'at-free villages or Islamist-free villages. Religion is not the only marker for our societies, nor is it the most important. I, for one, only read the Quran after I became an ex-Muslim and an atheist. I was born into it, just as nearly everyone is, depending on where they're born. It's geography and your parents' religion that mostly determine yours. In Iran, I didn't have to veil. I went to a mixed school. I wasn't treated differently because I was a girl. I hadn't heard the terms taqiyya or jihad, and religion only became relevant in my life when it came into power in Iran. Then the veil became an issue. Then Hezbollah types were sent to my school to separate the girls from the boys, though we ran circles around them. Then my school and others were closed down in order to Islamicize them. And then came the executions and the slaughter of an entire generation by what has become known in many places. Like the relation of Islam, Islamism, and Muslims has been the position of successive British governments, whereby multiculturalism and multi-faithism has been promoted as social policies to defend religion's role in the public space, impose religious identity as the only marker to define citizens, and hand over large segments of citizens to be managed and controlled by regressive Islamist organizations and parasitical imams. This has been part of the neocon project for the extreme right-wing restructuring of society. There are no more citizens, but segregated communities with their own faith schools, their own faith-based services, and even their own faith-based courts, separate and unequal. The far right too, can I give you my bad key, sorry. The far right too, which claims to despise multiculturalism, benefits from this idea of difference in order to scapegoat the other and to promote its own form of wild white identity politics. Ironically, left groups, and I say that as someone who is on the left, which are traditionally anti-state, reiterate the government's multiculturalism, multi-faithism, and identity politics, as well as the far-right narrative, and side with our oppressors by placing individuals into homogenized, restrictive boxes, denying diversity and dissent, and equating all Muslims with Islamists, albeit in different ways. Rather than siding with the vast secular and progressive movements in the so-called Muslim communities and the so-called Islamic world, this section of the left, the regressive left, they side with and push the Islamist narrative that denies universalism, sees rights and equality as Western, sees secularism as Western, and justifies the suppression of women, apostates, and blasphemers under the guise of respect for other cultures, imposing on innumerable people the most reactionary elements of culture and religion, which is that of the religious right wing. In the world of these apologists, the oppressor is the victim, the oppressed incite hatred, and of course any criticism is bigotry. Of course, where the Islamists are in power, there are no such niceties about concern for minorities and safe spaces. Dissenters are prosecuted for blasphemy, apostasy, enmity against God, full stop. People like Raif Badawi, sentenced to 10 years in prison and 1,000 lashes in Saudi Arabia for raising the question of religion and politics. People like Shahrukh Zamani, found dead in prison cell recently after being sentenced to 11 years in prison for labor organizing in Iran, where the right to strike is deemed to be haram or religiously forbidden. Women's rights campaigner Saad al-Shamari, who's imprisoned on accusations of insulting Islam and the Prophet in Saudi Arabia merely because she demanded an end to male guardianship rules. Or what about poet Fatima Naoud? She's on trial in Egypt for insulting Islam because she criticized Islamic animal slaughter. Or what about 47-year-old Roya Nobacht, sentenced initially to 20 years in prison in Iran when she went back to visit her family for insulting Islam, only because on Facebook she said that the Iranian regime is a little too Islamic. Saying Charlie Hebdo cartoonist had it coming is like saying that Shahrukh Zamani deserves to die or that Raif Badawi deserves his lashes for being inflammatory and offending Islam or the Islamists in power. Here, of course, rather than accusations of blasphemy or apostasy, critics face charges of Islamophobia and offense. What's packaged as the culture of offense is really Islamism's imposition of blasphemy laws under the pretext of respect for Muslim sensibilities. As I've said before, this is very much the government's line as well. In September, the police removed artwork by Mimsy from London's mall galleries, now because they said it would have potentially inflammatory content. And this is it. Basically, it shows mices lurking in the background, featuring children's toy, Sylvanian families, after the police raised serious concerns on the potentially inflammatory content. I'm going to show you three more of this inflammatory content. Try and avert your eyes if you cannot tolerate this sort of inflammatory content. And it's actually just a very good example of how Islamists prowl on the innocent, on civilians, while they're eating, while they're at the beach, while they're at school. The culture of offense, in my opinion, is a smokescreen. It serves to legitimize Islamist terror and blame the victims. And this is the point. Being a woman, being gay, being unveiled, being improperly veiled, being an atheist, going to school, driving a car, having sex, falling in love, laughing out loud, all of these things offend the Islamists. Calling for civility, censorship, safe spaces, silence, or respect for the offended is merely heeding the Islamist demand for submission at the expense of dissenters. But as Rosa Luxemburg has said, freedom is always the freedom of dissenters. charges of offense and Islamophobia aim not to prevent bigotry, in my opinion. You cannot stop bigotry by censorship, but to stop criticism and deflect legitimate outrage against Islamism, Israel aims to prevent blasphemy. And this is a great Jesus and Mo cartoon, so I'll give you a chance to read, which personifies this sort of accusations of racism. Calling it racism fails to understand that the other also has its dissenters who want to live free from religious stranglehold. Plus, isn't it racist to imply that all Muslims cannot tolerate criticism and free thought?
Why do you turn it off?
It's okay.
Why do you do that?
It's alright. Do not worry. It's alright.
So I'm going to leave again.
It's alright. It's alright. Just put it on again if you don't mind. Sorry, just 1 minute. We're just going to have that.
I'm so sorry.
Don't be sorry. This is. I actually like you to see this because nothing I say can prove what I'm talking about.
Give you a jacket, mate.
You don't have to be sorry. You don't have to apologize for anyone. You don't have to apologize for anyone. Please don't do that because my parents are in a country like you. Do not have to apologize for anyone. It's okay. Just 1 minute. We're going to turn it on. I have to wait because I want to show you something. So I'm sorry. I've got to wait for you. This is eating up into your own question and comment time, so which I'm sure you have lots of things to say. Did I turn it on right? I don't know what
it is.
Now, this is the example I wanted to give you was the problem with this inflation. You've got a group called Men, which is talking about how good it is that the UK police are going to record attacks as a separate hate crime, like anti-Semitism, which is a very good thing, recording hatred against Muslims, a very good thing, taking that seriously. But what I want to show you is how this is conflated. Later on they say, this is the first major step in completely outlawing Islamophobia in the UK. Make dua that just like anti-Semitism, anyone who writes or says anything malicious against Islam will be prosecuted in the future, inshallah. This is what I want to talk to you about, this conflation between criticism of an idea, criticism of a far-right movement versus bigotry against people. Huge, huge difference between that. In my opinion, I agree with the term anti-Muslim bigotry, but in my opinion, the term Islamophobia is a political term that's been coined by Islamists, by their apologists, in order to scaremonger people like me to silence and to censor dissent. The solution, in my opinion, lies in going back to basics. Citizenship rights, equality of people, irrespective of one's beliefs. Respect for people and not for religions and the religious right. An end to faith-based initiatives that divide and segregate. Universal rights, one law for all, with, of course, equal access to justice, because one of the things we're seeing are major cuts in legal aid and services for people. And, of course, I think it's important to have an uncompromising defense of secularism and the separation of religion from the state. And, of course, unconditional free expression. As the philosopher Roger Scruton said earlier this month, if you invoke the law at all, it should be protect those who give offense and not the one who takes it. But of course, everything is now the other way around. And to combat the normalization and legitimization of censorship, free thinkers, in my opinion, should celebrate blasphemy. They should celebrate apostasy. We're not allowed to leave Islam. We can be executed for leaving Islam in 13 countries. Then it becomes all the more important to renounce Islam publicly by groups like the Council of Ex-Muslims of Britain. This is a hashtag we started less than 2 weeks ago. It's had 100,000 tweets. And there's a lot of really, first of all, a lot of Muslims who've come out in support of this tweet, saying that I'm a Muslim, but I think people have a right to leave Islam if they want without threats. And also, there have been some really heart-wrenching stories of the issues that people have faced with having left Islam. And the difficulties of leaving a faith that your family believes in, and not wanting to hurt your family and upset your parents, while at the same time also speaking for yourself and believing what you'd like. When it's possible to shout one's atheism from every rooftop, then the very need to do so will no longer have the same urgency. Blasphemy and apostasy are not a denial of religious freedom. There can be no freedom of religion without freedom from religion. They're linked to each other. You can't just defend the right to religion without also defending the right of people to be able to leave religion if they want without threats and intimidation. And I think in this day and age, in the age of ISIS, criticism of religion is an essential aspect of being fully human. This is a picture of Kurdish fighters in Sinjar, which was taken over by ISIS. They kicked ISIS out and they are burning the ISIS flag. Those who consider these sort of acts or apostasy or blasphemy as culturally inappropriate, Western, colonialist, they're only considering Islamism sensibilities and values and not those who resist. Here's another wonderful picture of a Kurdish fighter breaking down a billboard that had been set up by ISIS telling women to dress in that way. This is after Sinjar was liberated. Only when we begin to see dissent, acknowledge that it is linked to our own, and defend universal values, will we be able to truly honor our dissenters, stand with them, and push back the religious right. Clearly, free expression is key in all of this. It's not a luxury, it's not a privilege, it's not up for sale. And for many of us, it is the only way that we can fight to breathe, to challenge those in power who stifle us, and to demand change. Limiting free expression is not just censorship, as Salman Rushdie says, it's an assault on human nature. Human beings, he says, shape their futures by arguing and challenging and saying the unsayable, not by bowing their knee, whether to gods or to men. In the age of ISIS, I think, this is a historical task, a necessity. I would like to end with a plea on behalf of migrants. There's a lot of things that are said about migrants. They're either all response, they're all supposedly ISIS and jihadis. They're all here for, I don't know, to take welfare and to shop for the best welfare that's available to them. Whereas in fact, if you look at those numbers who are fleeing, they're fleeing from countries where there's war, US-led militarism, as well as Islamism. Syrians, people from Iran, people from Afghanistan. There are people who are fleeing real human rights violations. And I think it's crucial that if we oppose Islamism and the far right, if we defend people's right to live as they choose, then we must also defend migrants and refugees. In my opinion, they are some of the best in our societies because they refuse to live under conditions that are unfair, and they dream that they can actually manage to survive the horrendous journey that they have to go through in order to have a better life. There's a wonderful picture of some Iranian migrants at the border, Macedonian border, and they've got a sign, they've got all these police in front of them, and they've got a sign saying, we want freedom too. And that's why I think it is hugely important to also defend the rights of migrants. Thank you very much.
Well, depends on how many questions are, I suppose. I mean, thank you for getting
Sure, of course.
I think it's very brutal to do so, just like it's happened. If anybody has any questions, you're welcome to ask now.
You know, it's really funny how you're criticising Islam and you're talking about Islam so freely, but you read the Quran after you left Islam. So how do you have the courage and how do you have the audacity to read it? I'm sorry, I'm going to read it, to talk about Islam so freely when you don't even, like, you didn't have the mindset to even, like, you know, to open up the book.
I'm sorry, can I just get a pen? Sorry, I'll forget your question. This doesn't work. Can I get a pen? Sorry about that.
Sorry.
Yeah, sorry, go ahead. So the audacity to talk about Islam?
Yeah, after you left Islam, you opened up the Quran because you said, you know, hijab is not compulsory, or this isn't compulsory, or that's not that, Islam is another. Well, in the Quran, if you had read it beforehand, you would have had all the answers.
Okay, thank you. Yes? So shall I just I'll let you do it.
Maybe we'll do two at a time, so if you want.
I think you should really also distinguish between ISIS and these extremists and Islam as a religion. I can assure you that no one in this university supports ISIS. And by the way, my dad is a convert, so he's not forced. I'm not forced to be Muslim. My parents aren't even religious. I chose to put this on. I'm the only one in my family that has it on, so I chose that. So liberation is not. I chose to do that. I'm free to do that. And yeah, you gave examples of two Muslim countries out of, I think, 47 Muslim countries in the world, Iran and Saudi Arabia, the most extreme Muslim countries that all of us disagree with on so many things. So that's not Islam. That's not Islam. These are crazy people. And you see crazy people, you see extremists in all religions, and you see extremists, atheists as well. It's just, so you need to, yeah.
Thank you.
One more?
My name's Bob. I'm actually not a Goldsmith student, sorry, because people can't see me, sorry if I turn around. I wanted to make 3 points. I'm at the University of East London. The first point, there wasn't much in what you said that I disagreed with, but I noticed that you're from One Law for All, and I had a bit of a look up before I came to this meeting at kind of what they put forward, and what was conspicuously lacking from what One Law for All said was saying, well, actually addressing things like the Prevent Programme, like controls on immigration, these are British laws which are applied to all, but which are extremely pernicious and discriminatory against black and Asian people predominantly in this country. But I'd kind of leave it to you to kind of answer. The second point is about the safe space thing. It kind of came up in the discussion of it. I was a sabbatical officer at the University of Liverpool, and on occasion we had to invoke the idea of safe space. But the times we did it, there was one occasion when the British National Party, because they were running in the election to be mayor, the university management invited them to a panel at the university, and we argued as a student union, said we cannot allow these people on campus, not because we disagree with them. I think there's a very clear distinction between someone you can have a civilised discussion with. What happened when the BNP came on campus is we had to fight them. One of our students got a broken jaw. We had to physically prevent them from attacking. Well, what they wanted to do was rove around campus attacking black students. But the third, so I think there's a distinction, and I think brings me on to my third point, is actually how, for the most part, how I think white British leftists speak to like Asian people and people they perceive to be Muslim is to kind of say, well, you know, oh, I think this kind of happens in the political culture of Goldsmiths a bit, you know, oh, we'll discuss, you know, stuff about gay rights and everything, but that's for a certain time. But when we're going out into town hamlets or something, what do we want to say to people? It's like, oh, you're against the war, right? And actually just trying to address people as more two-dimensional, not having the complex ideas. And actually the serious and thoughtful Muslims that I've met are very willing to have discussions and very willing to have their ideas challenged, and it's not seen as like offensive or something that you have to keep away from them. And I think that's the kind of point we want to encourage, a political culture of healthy debate on the basis of honesty. So that means I'm not going to pretend to agree with someone on occasions when I'm not, and I think that's a much better basis for solidarity. If you don't respect someone as a fully thinking human being, which I think what a lot of the sort of white left do with Muslims is just kind of confine the discussion to, you know, just basically expecting you to have certain things in your head anyway. I think that's actually much more racist than saying, well, yes, I don't believe in God, I'm for gay rights, I think that the Islamic Republic of Iran should be overthrown. So yeah.
Okay, just quickly, going back to the whole point about the safe space, I agree with everyone who's entitled to their own opinion, but sorry I'm saying this, but you were kind of being like a keyboard warrior earlier. We're talking about someone who was talking about, talking about the car being a mobile place and whatever. You can bring people in, you can do whatever, but if you're going to invite someone in, of course put forward your opinion, but don't come out and criticise other people, their beliefs, doing whatever it is. You have no right to do that. Saying something that you were a mobile prison, that's disgusting. I truly see that as disgusting, and you can't say something like that.
Can I now respond to this? Thank you. I mean, the thing is that I think that we have to make a distinction between criticising ideas or criticising practices that we disagree with versus attacking people. And, as someone who was forced to wear the veil in Iran, for example, and as someone who has defended the right to wear the veil for adult women, by the way, this is not my position. If you go and look at my position is that the burqa is a mobile prison. And I'm sorry, I really believe that. I think it just doesn't allow women to move and to breathe. And you might think it's fine. This is the point. But I have a right to say that I think it is a violation of women's rights. I can say that. And it's the same way that I can say, well, I don't like FGM, but no one will tell me that I'm attacking girls and women who are mutilated. They did 20 years ago, they did. They don't anymore. Because the struggle against FGM has gone so forward that women's rights activists can't say that to me anymore. With regards to the veil too, I think we can have a discussion about the veil that I think, that the veil is a tool for the control of women. It is a tool to restrict women. It might be some people's choice. I'm not disagreeing with that, of course. But I think on a large scale, you're talking about women who are living in Britain here. On a large scale, it is not a choice for many women, and that needs to be acknowledged. Can I finish, please, and then we can have more questions and comments.
Is that okay?
Just wait 1 minute.
It
actually is a choice.
And so, I mean, again, though, if we're talking about child veiling, I think child veiling is a form of child abuse. So there's a distinction between adult veiling and child veiling. I think they're very distinct from each other. On the issue of, well, how can I have the audacity to speak about the Quran? I mean, I think that you don't even need to have read the Quran. I'm answering your question.
So you're going to talk about book without reading.
Excuse me, you need to wait for your turn.
I'm not going to wait for any of
your questions. On your question about how can I have the audacity to speak about Islam, well, I can, in the same way that I might not be a black South African, but I have the audacity to speak about what I think is wrong. If I might not be a conservative, I'm not, I'm a communist. I might not be a conservative, but I have a right to talk about conservatism. I may not have, because that's what people are. We have opinions about things. I'm not telling you you can't speak about atheists because you're not one. Yeah, I'm not telling you you're not allowed to speak about atheism because you haven't read.
Everyone respected your time to speak. Stop shouting stuff out.
If you're going to keep shouting stuff out, then.
So the point is that having lived in an Islamic state, having lived under Sharia law, I don't agree with it. I think Sharia law is misogynist, it's homophobic, it's inhuman, and that people have a right to challenge and dissent. And also, for all of you here who are defending it, do you know that the vast majority of people who are sentenced to death, who are in prison, women who are facing are not being given the right to divorce, a majority of them are Muslims, yeah? So there is, the whole point of my speech was that we must make a distinction between ideas versus the religious right versus Muslims. In fact, I think I've done that. On the other issue, on the fact that No, he doesn't have to. He doesn't have to.
Yeah, but why can't you guys let her speak? You've had your time to speak. We respected you. We said, okay, speak. We all listened to your opinion. You did. Can she not answer your question? And then, after she answers your question, you can say whatever you want, right?
I mean, I think that was one of my points, is that when you look at the British left, a large segment of it, and I'm someone who's on the left myself, they have one set of progressive politics for themselves and another for Muslims. And the rest of us, we are only allowed to criticize Islam, criticize Islamism within the confines that has been given to us by identity politics and multiculturalism. And that's why there is this, because of this conflation, it's very difficult to criticize, and also anyone who does is considered an Islamophobe and racist, whereas there's a huge distinction between criticizing a belief, criticizing a religious right, and also criticizing people. Yeah, because for example, my father is also Muslim. A lot of my family members are also Muslim. They don't want my death because I'm an apostate. They respect me, they have treated me always fairly, and that is the reality. And I think the point is that it's important for Muslims, ex-Muslims, all of us, to make it very clear that attacking Islam, criticizing Islam, it's an idea. Criticizing the religious right, it's a political movement. It is very different from bigotry against Muslims. I have a duty to criticize Islamism because of what Islamism is doing across the world. Not just to free thinkers, not just to apostates and blasphemers, but to Muslims as well. Because for me, people are more important than imagined identities and my sort of religious identity or non-identity.
You've had your hand up for a while, right? So.
We'll do three questions.
Sorry, can you?
I'm from Nigeria, where Muslims and Christians mix. My grandma was Muslim and my granddad was Christian, we got married. It's perfectly fine. But I can also criticize and say, okay, there's some things that I don't agree with. But it's one thing to criticize, another thing to be disrespectful. Because I'm a Christian, and people that disrespect God, you can't do that around me. It's just not fair, because you have to back what you're saying to the proper point. And for Jesus, like, I feel like what you're saying, like, one side you're saying, oh, there's, like, Islamists and then there's Muslims, but then you find a way of then linking them together, and we're not making a distinction between your talk. Basically, you started by saying there's Islamists and Muslims, but then you basically try to say that they're the same. Yeah, everyone in this room would say so.
Yeah,
and secondly,
millions of Muslims condemn the killing of these people, but you make it seem like Islam
loves them. Not only towards Muslim people, but towards black people, which I'm head of illustrated for you. And black people don't stand for it either. So to say that Islam and black people are violent. I can definitely see where they're coming from, because they're having hate incited against them. But nobody's talking about that. You want to talk about the other side. ISIS is killing Muslims.
Can I?
You're saying that's what you said, but you also said some other offensive things. That's
why. This is a woman from Iran, I think people should understand, from that country, who's speaking here today in front of us as a human being.
telling us about her experience of which was better, because she's literally speaking about, let her speak. And then if you disagree, you can like raise your hand if I disagree. You don't have to attack something. I feel so ashamed. Like,
oh, no.
I can't. I really want to have a
change. No, no, no.
What do I mean?
Go ahead.
Sorry, what makes me so angry that
what?
You have to attack
something? Yeah, I mean, I'm mostly attacking that because I read the Quran. I pray 5 times a day. But I have people like you guys who are just constantly putting a bad name to Islam.
On the issue of offense, I mean, again, the thing is that there are many things that offend me. Yeah? Apostasy laws in Islam offend me. The fact that I am threatened to death because I want to leave Islam offends me. The fact that 13 countries, it's not funny, 13 countries are British. 13 countries are punishing people who are being apostates and blasphemers to death. This is a reality for a large number of people. And it's not just atheists like myself who are being punished, because in many countries people won't even admit that they're atheists because it is punishable by death. It includes people who are Muslims because they didn't do exactly what the state expected them, an Islamic state.
Yeah,
okay. You might tell me this is not a real state, this is not real Islam, fine. But you don't decide what real Islam is. It's the Islamist movement with power that decides. And they decide with their guns and their gallows and their death penalty.
But it's not true.
She's not saying it's true.
She's not saying that is Islam. She's saying Islamism.
Okay,
that's
now,
what power gives
you.
Well, then give them a different name.
What I'm saying is that in a situation where I'm just talking about my own experience, that I'm facing death threats. I had to leave Iran because of the death penalty for apostates. Do I not have a right to say that people have a right to leave Islam, that people have a right to criticize Islam, without fear and intimidation? That apostasy laws, even if you think that someone who is a blasphemer and an apostate is a disgusting, vile human being, doesn't that person have a right to live? And to live as they choose without fear? I'm sure a majority of Muslims agree with me. Yes. So this is what I'm saying. But even raising this issue is deemed offensive by some. But I'm saying that's all right. I am, frankly, if I'm going to be frank, I'm offended by surahs in the Quran. I'm offended by Sharia law. I am, because that's my opinion. It might not offend you, it offends me. But that doesn't mean that I don't think my father has a right to be a Muslim. It doesn't mean that people don't have a right. Of course they have a right. And my beliefs are offensive to some people. That's fine. The point is that when we immediately say that anyone who criticizes is offensive, we are trying to shut down debate. What's the problem? I can listen to Islamists talk day in and day out about women, about ex-Muslims, about gay people. I can handle it. Yeah, we live in a world where we have differences of opinion. If we cannot speak because it offends the other, we're not going to be able to say anything, because in reality, we are all offended by something. I'm offended by things. You're offended. There's none of us here that finds nothing offensive. It's not possible. So, you know, charging anyone who comes to say something as, you know, you're being offensive, you've got to do that. And I think the main point here is this. You can hate my ideas. It's not the same as hating me. Yeah, and it's the same for me. I can hate certain ideas. It doesn't mean that I'm anti-Muslim or that I don't want equality for everyone, Muslim or not. Don't forget, many of my family are Muslim. And I know, but what I'm saying is that, and also the racists can't tell us apart. You know, for racists, we're all Muslims. I'm actually an undercover jihadi because I defend migrant rights, for example, according to the far right, and so on and so forth. So this is what I want to say. Charlie Hebdo may offend you, but it doesn't offend me. And I think that's the issue here, yeah? we should be able to talk about it and agree that we will not necessarily agree on everything. My point is that let's offend each other if we have to. Let's disagree if we have to. But that's not the same as disrespecting people. And that those are two very, very different things. The other thing I want to talk about is Islamophobia. I didn't say that racism and bigotry against Muslims doesn't exist. Of course it does. Of course it does. It's you know, it's especially after every attack of Islamists, because everybody conflates the Islamists with Muslims, we do see an increase in attacks. Of course it happens. How can we live in racist societies? How can Muslims not be attacked but everybody else is who's brown? Of course it happens. My point is only this, that I agree Muslimophobia exists. I think Muslimophobia is as despicable as all forms of bigotry. But the term, I have a problem with the term Islamophobia, because what it implies is a phobia against an idea. And that is not bigotry against people. What I want to say is that you can oppose an idea, you can oppose, you might have this atheist phobia, you might hate atheism, but it doesn't mean you are bigoted against atheists. This is the point I was trying to make in my entire talk.
I just want to draw your attention to the fact that you have to divide between culture and religions. Topics such as this. You saying things like Islamism is, to me, representing extremism, and that extremism has nothing to do with Islam. I just want to draw your attention to that, first of all. And also, coming back to the child and the incident, why is it that atheists or anti-Islam, let me just say in this context, why is it that when they insult our prophet, the one that we believe in, why is it that they get away with it and we should respect them, but when it comes to our views, it's not respected? I want to just raise this point here. And the fact that concepts such as ISIS, all of this 9/11 stuff, everyone knows that the Western world can do these things. And it's just, everyone knows right now.
How do you know that?
Everyone knows. Oh,
I read the Quran when I was quite young, and all of my family goes to the Muslims. And in no way do they support ISIS, and in no way do they believe, you know, most of what it says in the Quran. Yes, they follow their religion, and a lot of them cover, and you know, that's fine, it's respected. But I just want to say that I read the Quran when I was younger, and there are a lot of passages that are violent, and that tells you to be violent, and to, you know, to hate Jewish people. No, none of my family believe that. None of my family would do that.
Can I say something?
Go ahead. None of my family would. None of my family would, you know, believe that. You know, I know so many people that they don't do that. 99% of Muslims don't believe that.
There's a whole verse in the Quran that says, you live your religion and I'll live my religion. That's it, we leave each other.
And you know that Muslim men are allowed to marry Jewish. You're allowed to marry Jewish.
Exactly, Muslim men are allowed to.
You don't have to hate Jews.
Okay.
You're allowed to. So, does anyone have another comment?
Something I think you mentioned about criticizing Islam and people not really accepting it, I think it's just like 30, 40 years ago, people in this country made something like Life of Brian that took a mickey of Christianity. And I mean, day in and day out, if you look around, you see caricatures of Jesus, right? or others. But the thing is, you see, you don't see this kind of reaction, and that's acceptable. And please, you see, this is 21st century, and you should kind of tolerate other people's view and you know, criticism, and there's nothing wrong with it. And the thing is, the only problem to be for me, the only reason I have this kind of fury when you hear Christians of Islam is done is role of organization of Islam that is supported by the state and by other Islamic Muslims outside, not by ordinary Muslims who want freedom, who want tolerance, who want like a normal life, you know what I mean? And I think it's because of organized Islamists in this country that ordinary Muslims are put in a corner and they are all the time pointed at, you know what I mean? And what Maryam Namazie is doing, in my opinion, is to set those people who are put in the corner free. And that's the point, okay, what I mean.
Hello everybody, my name is Magdalene. I'm a women rights campaigner and I'm from Libya and I studied in a mosque and I read the Quran and it's called Glory in Arabic. And I just want to make a comment about women rights in Islam because this is what I was campaigning for in Libya and I was abducted by Islamists for 3 days. And this, what's happening now, is really makes fear from my stomach, and it reminds me of what I've been through from Islamists being kidnapped for 3 days. And women rights in Islam, there are a lot of things against human rights. We were just fighting for inheritance rights. We were fighting for.
She's from Libya. Libya.
Inheritance rights, because inheritance and Islam are not the same for men as for women. So it's only the women have half. Why the women should have half of the man's rights for inheritance? That's unlogically, that's unacceptable, that's against women's rights, against the human rights. Another point was the shahada in the accord, which is what's shahada testimony in the court. Women are not allowed to give testimony in court unless they are accompanied by 4 women or 2 women and a man. So their testimony is half the man's testimony because they might forget, and so the other women would remind her, which is, it's not logical, and this is what we were fighting for, and many things, beating the wife if she's not obedient, if it's not even, she's not
beating your wife, beating a wife should not be.
Yes. Do you understand that you live in the UK?
Yes, I understand I live in the UK. Yes.
They want to hear from my voice from where?
Listening.
Yes,
I'm all ears.
Yeah. When خفتم نشوزهن فضربهن فجروهن في المضاجع أوقات أو
speaking English.
I'm quoting the Quran. So this is what we were fighting for women's rights to be the same as in legal terms in the law. Can I finish my point? So that's the only thing that we were campaigning for in Libya, and we were fighting for, and we went in the street for demonstration. When I was kidnapped, they accused me of women trafficking, of prostitution, women using women for prostitution, just because we were asking for freedom for women. I mean, this is ridiculous. And don't tell me that Islamic Sharia law are protecting women's rights. I'm a law student. I studied law.
What makes you think
I studied Sharia law. I studied Sharia law. I'm a law student. speaking from a knowledge.
What knowledge? What makes you right?
Let her speak and you can ask your question in a second.
She's frozen,
just, no, she just
maybe,
ask her
maybe,
question.
I think
just
we may have run out of time, so I'd like Maryam maybe
to ask. I guess you'll be your question.
Before you say something wrong,
I understand that we don't have.
Women wait for
reality. What is falling? What makes them right?
How is it really screaming?
I am so sorry for the experience that you had in Libya. I'm totally for you. However, we're not in Libya. Okay, this is UK. This, if that happened in the UK,
it's
right now, I would protest with you. It's culture, it's not Islam.
It's not culture, yeah.
And I guess it is. Just let her ask her question.
In some countries, the Sharia law is not how it should be.
Yeah.
And maybe me,
we
campaign, and that would be with you, standing with you and protesting. Okay? So I'm with you. I understand you had such a bad experience, but you have to understand that in this country, stuff like that doesn't happen. So we obviously we're going to be defensive. And with you as well, you also had a bad experience, obviously. And we need to calm down.
But it's not about country, it's about Islam.
I'm sorry, she's just having finished.
Sorry, I've got to go. And also because the reality is we're not really having a discussion.
Yeah.
We're shouting at each other. It's quite difficult. I would stay for 3 hours more if I felt we were able to have a discussion, but we're
why
not.
Why can't we?
Because there are ISOC members here who
you
know
saw
what they did.
Okay.
And now every
they
time
not,
there's
not
a closing meeting,
we're not
meeting. We have to hear.
If you give us
no,
time,
you
want, there won't be any point of view. One will shout out.
Exactly.
Are you the one who turned off?
Yeah, excuse me. Are you going to apologize for that?
Well, that's one thing.
Well, that was on camera.
Everything else may be that.
I think the thing is that I'd like to end
the thing is, you come here with a moral judgment thinking you're right. What's your basis for what's right? Who are you to tell us we're wrong?
And religion.
And to smell all the same
as
a Bangladeshi or a thing outside of us. Indonesia isn't Saudi Arabia. They're Muslim countries.
I think
that.
I think. Excuse me. I am talking. For God's sake. For God's sake. Get out.
You need to get out.
Shut up.
Stay. Like you've just been.
In the same way, I also have an opinion. Madeleine also has an opinion. We think that this comes from Islamic laws, but with this exception and this understanding, that this doesn't mean that all Muslims, of course, think that. Of course, they don't. And also that Islam, as a personal belief, is a lived experience, which means that there are many Muslims who are pro women's rights, who are pro equality, who are pro gay rights, even who are pro anything, you name it, progressive politics, pro labor organizing, all of that. Okay. But when you have the religious right in power, it is impossible for people to speak and to breathe. That is the reality. Look, because it's a fact. I'm not giving you my opinion, it's a fact. Because if you live in Iran, if you live in Saudi Arabia, if you live even in Jordan, in Morocco, if you live in any country that you think is good,
Pakistan.
If you live in Afghanistan, if you live in Bangladesh, if you live, what I'm saying is that if you, and also if you live here in Britain, because they have Sharia courts in this country, with thousands upon thousands of women being denied their right to divorce, being denied their right to child custody, girls getting nothing in return for their daughters, that is part of Sharia courts. So the point I'm trying to make is that we can have this discussion about culture and religion forever, but unless we have the right to choose what we want to think and how we want to live, none of us are really free. And the point I'm making is when the religious right is in power, none of us can choose. Because even there are many Muslims who don't necessarily want to live the way an Islamic regime tells them to live, and they can't. Forget about the apostates and the blasphemers and the minorities, religious minorities. So what I want to say is that the way forward to this is, in a sense, an end to the power of political Islam.
And it's not just political Islam, it's all forms of religious right. The Hindu right in India has been responsible for massacre of Muslims in Gujarat. You've got the Buddhist right now in Sri Lanka and Myanmar massacring Muslims as we speak. You've got the Jewish right, and look what they're doing in the Palestinian territories. So the Christian right, they just bombed an abortion clinic a few days ago, or whenever, earlier than. What I want to say is that when the religious right are in power, no one can speak or live the way they want. And so, you know, whether you think it's religion or culture is not really the actual point. The point is, do we agree that Islamism should have power? Do you believe in a caliphate? If you do, that's where, because I won't be able to stay alive in a caliphate. And that's the problem. That's the problem. And also many Muslims cannot stay alive in the caliphate.
Can I just say something?
Yes.
You said that with religions being in control, you can't really live freely. I'd say if you have real religion in control, you can live freely. But what is in your country and in other countries, and I said earlier, I think you ignored my point, is that this is not Islam, this is not the real religion. A lot of Muslims campaign against these countries, we don't even agree. These are two countries out of 47 other Muslim countries. You have Malaysia, you have other Muslim countries in the world that are not that extreme. So this is not real religion in power.
Okay, what is real religion in power? Do you have an example so we can talk
about it? Honestly, yeah. I don't see any country in the world following real Islam.
Okay.
So I do have a, yeah, but that's the thing. So I'm saying, that's the thing. You need to distinguish between these extreme countries that are not even representing the real Islam and Islam as a religion.
So thank you for that. Okay. So I think we're sort of getting to some point here, maybe.
No,
listen to me for a second, yeah? The thing is that you're saying that there's nothing that is real Islam, yeah? And I'm saying, there's no state now that is real Islam.
No country,
yeah,
that
no
is
state,
100%,
and no country
right.
that is real Islam. Okay. And I'm saying that it's Islamic. Fine. That's not the main point. The main point, though, is that if there is no country that's real Islam, but a lot of these groups are saying that they're Islamic.
But they're not.
Okay, they're not. But the point is that you don't decide that I have a right to live. ISIS does, the Iranian regime does.
Come on.
That's very mature.
Sorry, I thought we were having a discussion.
Can you ring the key?
Very sophisticated way to live.
So my point is that even if we agree that it's not real Islam, because my dad would say that as well, yeah, this is not real Islam. And you know, because I know my dad is the most lovely person in the world, I would say, you know, he really believes it's not real Islam. I believe it is. But that's not the point. My point is that these are countries that are saying that they're Islam. They're imposing Sharia rules. Yeah? They're also quoting from the Quran, from the Hadith, from Islamic jurisprudence. So my point is that it's not you who's very nice and having a discussion with me who decides my rights under Islamic State. They can do it. It's them. So whether you agree with it or not, they're the ones who decide what we are.
Yeah, but they're wrong and we're against them. We're just and we're against them. So that is
I mean, fine. But there are
you want to come
but that's why
I'm not with you.
Okay.
I can come up now and tell you how bad these people
so what
are.
I want to say is though that
not Islam.
What is the solution? That's what we need to
do. It's not to get rid of Islam.
I didn't say to get rid of Islam. I never said to get
you said if there's religion and control.
But I said political Islam. I'm calling them Islamists. And that's
real Islam.
I said that the Islamists, the Hindu right, the Jewish right, the Buddhist right, the Christian right. If they don't have political power, there is more of a chance for us all to be able to live in a society, whether we're believers and whether we're non-believers. Because good Muslims do not make the laws in Iran, in Saudi Arabia, in Indonesia, in Malaysia, in the north of Nigeria, in Indonesia's Aceh Valley has brought stoning now, they have brought floggings and amputations. This is different from Muslims. This is about a far-right political movement that uses Islam as its banner, but that is first and foremost a political movement. If we don't make these distinctions, we're not going to get anywhere. We're not going to get anywhere.
Conversation about something that is a matter of life and death for many Muslims as well, for many Muslims. But if we're not even allowed to come to a university at Goldsmiths to say that people have a right to live Islam, that I have a right not to be called a kafir, that I have a right not to have people who I admire, who are my heroes, like Raif Badawi, facing 10 years in prison in Saudi Arabia, or you know that beloved Bangladeshi bloggers who happen to be atheists and seculars are hacked to death in the public. Well, you know, I'm sorry if it offends some people, that's fine. Learn to be offended, but also learn to understand that if you want the right to religion, which is a fundamental right, you must also understand that that right is intrinsically linked with the right to be able to leave religion. If people can only become Muslims, if they can only convert into Islam, but they can never leave, that's not really very good for your religion, is it? Because it's basically saying that you can come and you can never leave. The religion is not confident enough to allow people to come and go as they choose. Mm-hmm. You know, and when we fight for apostasy and blasphemy, I know you don't like it, but that fight opens the space for many dissenters, including many Muslim dissenters, because don't forget, there are many Muslim dissenters, many, who consider themselves Muslims, who are proud to be Muslims, but they are facing, Osama Hussein, he's a theologian, but just because he said women and men have the right to equality, he's got death threats. In Britain, his family runs a Sharia court, one of the worst Sharia courts. What I'm saying is that this is not just my fight as a apostate, in the same way that the fight for women's equality is not just a fight for men, for women, it's also a fight for men. The fight for apostates is not just a fight for apostates, it's a fight for everybody to be able to think as they want and to have opinions that are not that are controversial, that are considered inflammatory, and to have a right to do that.
Yeah, I understand what you mean. I'm just
saying,
for
instance,
like, So what I was saying was that it's like, for instance, the reason why I wanted to bring that up is because Hitler doesn't represent Christianity, even
okay.
though he done his thing to the label of
Christianity. Okay.
So what I'm saying is that these kind of thoughts, I understand that they're informative, but they can go in a way where they can influence and push hatred towards Islam. They can go either way. They could be open to us that have it, like we can listen and we understand what we're saying. But they can also fall in the wrong hands of people who are already very extreme against Islam and incite hate.
My point is though that my first enemy is Islamism.
because I think it is many of ours, yeah, and the religious right in general. But also, can I please also be able to say I don't like Islam without fearing for my life, without having my meeting disrupted? Is that possible? In the same way that you have a right to defend your religion, and I defend that right, can you also defend my right to say I don't like Islam? I don't want to be Muslim anymore. And you know what? I hate all religions. I think religions are medieval, superstitious, anti-woman, homophobic ideas. And can you please? That's my fight, yeah? So, no, okay, well, look, this. I've told you, nobody has to apologize for the behavior. This is not a collective community. I don't speak for all ex-Muslims, and those who try to disrupt the meeting don't speak for all Muslims either, and I don't speak for all ex-Muslims. But what I'm saying is that nobody has to apologize for anyone. We speak as individuals about issues that are important to us. But what I'm trying to say is that when I speak, I'm banned. I've got security. I've got people disrupting my meetings. Why? I'm called Islamophobic. I'm called inciting hatred. If there's any hatred incited, it's against us who are apostates and blasphemers. We're the ones who have death threats against us. But if I come and speak, I'm discriminating against a minority. I'm a minority within a minority. Why can't I speak? What's the problem? What is everyone so afraid of? And this is the issue. When we create an environment where, you know, if it was anybody other than me, they wouldn't have come into this hall. They would have been too intimidated. But I've fought this Islamic regime for 30 years in my country, so this does not intimidate me. But what I want to say is that this shuts down debate, and it doesn't allow us to discuss issues which are a matter, I've said this before, a matter of life and death for all of us, not just for me.
Sorry. I just want to bring your attention to the fact that in Islam, we believe in something called free will. Mm-hmm. And coming back to the point you said about leaving Islam, I respect you as a person wanting to leave Islam and not agreeing with certain aspects or core aspects of Islam itself. Free will provides you with that right to leave, use your mind to make these decisions, make these choices. And also bring it back to the fact about the lady that brought about the fact that women's rights are, you know, abolished in Libya. And you bringing up all these extremist cases in so many different countries around the world. But to me, that proves the fact that this issue is mainly cultural rather than Islam itself. To me, that proves the point. Rather than proving that Islam is, you know, a religion promoting violence in every single way, you know? I just want to make that point.
Please turn and I'd like to say something about that.
It's not uncultural. Libya was to be a secular society. We didn't have a problem at all. It started in 2011.
Well, why does
it started in 2011 because Islamists took over the country and they started abolishing a lot of laws. In Libya, the second wife wasn't allowed. In Libya, women had their rights before, and they were equal to men in all the legal aspects. And then when the Islamists took over, they start changing the laws according to Islamic Sharia. And women, they cannot travel without mahram, a common guardian. They are not allowed to be in the street without hijab. They are not, they abolished the law for marrying a second wife because it was banned in Libya, and then they brought it back. A man can marry four times, is fine, without even consulting his first wife. A woman, if she wants to get divorced, she goes to her family house. They call her back according to Betita. What is the Betita in English? When they call women according to Sharia law, Betita? Do you know?
They have to obey. They cannot.
Betita, it's a Sharia law. So, I mean, I fought for women's rights and I had to leave my country. And I studied Sharia law. I studied the Quran. I went to the mosque. I mean, I know what's going on, and this is my opinion. And if you think that this is not in the Islam and it's not in the Sharia law, I really advise you to read. And another thing, the leaving the Islam, according to Islamic Sharia, there is something called haddur ridda. Haddur ridda is killing in Islam. If you leave Islam, you have to be killed. That's haddur ridda. And if you disagree, and if you think I am wrong, I just advise you to go and search. That's all I can do.
I advise you.
That's your opinion. I'm not saying you are wrong. I'm not insulting. I'm not here to insult anybody. Seriously, I'm not here. I'm sorry. Just a moment. I'm not here to insult you. I'm not insulting you. I am saying if you think what I say is wrong, just make sure. That's
you
all.
Told me also, I've been told you're going to read the Quran. It's okay, okay? But the thing is that we can not agree with each other and still respect each other as people.
Well, she's not respecting
us. I am respecting you.
That's all right. First of all, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I studied in Quran school. I know the Quran by heart. And I'm not here to speak about Islam. I'm here to speak about the facts. Let's speak about, I'm not here to speak about faith of people, I'm speaking about what is happening in countries with Islamic state religion. I came from a country where Islamic state religion, where you go for more prison if you're gay, if you speak about Islam, if you speak about monarchy, more than if you molest kids. And you got child molesters that go for 2 or 3 years in prison. I read 7 to 15 years in prison that I get on my back in my country because of speaking against Islam. Al-Azhar in 2015, the biggest Sunni authority in the world, called the President Sisi to execute all atheists and anyone who reads Arabic, they can go and check. In 2015 in Kuwait, someone who just wrote in Twitter something about Islam and they go for 15 years in prison. I don't care about what Quran said or what the Hadith say. What I care about is the laws that are implemented today in 2015 in those countries. In Tunisia, someone only shared the Danish cartoons on Facebook. What happened? 7.5 years in prison, while people who went to the American embassy and stoned the American embassy and destroyed the American embassy got 2 years suspended in prison. People, because they say there is no Allah, there is no God in Indonesia, they're in prison for 5-6 years. So we're not here having a theological debate. But what we're having is actual life stories of people that are being languishing in prison, that are dead of fear to speak against Islam in countries where Islam is state religion. And you say, what if people who hate Islam instrumentalize this speech against Islam? But what about all those who instrumentalize Islam and hate speech to kill apostates and all that? What about all those who kill people in the name of Islam and instrumentalized it? Actually, the big death toll that exists ever is that the people who killed in the name of Islam. And as we speak about misogyny and misandry, if the case is there's many events where people hated Muslims and anti-Muslim bigotry, but the biggest picture here is when Muslims, when those terrorists, when those Islamists attack in the name of Islam. So when people use the Quran, and you can say misquote or whatever, to do what ISIS are doing, what Al-Shabaab are doing, what Mujahideen, in Azawad, in Mali, destroyed a very authentic manuscript of 12th century of Islam. So I think it is not on us, really, it's not the priority that people who use our thing, when Allah himself cannot protect his book from being used by people to do all the atrocities that are being done in this time, today, in all those Islamic countries.
He's a representative of you.
Of course, Ahmed bin Habib. Okay. Me.
That's the only point.
Sorry, yeah. Can
you
let her speak
this
one? Go ahead.
I think I've noticed a double standard. If we, like us Muslims, didn't agree with the laws in the UK, you would be told to leave, like go back to your country. However, if you don't agree with the laws in Muslim countries, why are you guys not told to leave? Mm-hmm. I don't get that. Why don't you go to a country where your rights and your free will or whatever is respected? I don't understand.
Can I explain that? I understand what you're saying. But the thing is that you're right. I mean, I'm told to, the minute I defend migrant rights, I'm told to go back home. And it's interesting because no matter how many generations your family has lived in this country, we're never citizens, you know. The minute you disagree on basic fundamental things, they tell you to go back home. And I tell them, well, if, you know, where are you going to send the white EDL supremacist or Britain first? You never say, send them home. But the minute you have a discussion, even with Islamists that I oppose, you know, the solutions are always deportation, send them back home. Send them where? Many of them are British born. If they've done a crime, well, arrest them. Why send them to another country to make the lives of other people miserable? If they haven't done a crime, well, they're you know, I don't think hate speech even should be criminalized. In my opinion, a lot of what the Islamists say, a lot of what the Islamic societies say in this country are hate speech against apostates. But, you know, hate speech, I think some things that are in religious texts could be considered hate speech against apostates, fine. People should be allowed to speak, including the BNP, including UKIP, all these disgusting groups should be allowed to speak, Islamists should be allowed to speak, because that is where we can have a debate and discussion and challenge views that are inhuman and unfair. So, you know, telling people to leave is not the solution. I think we're dealing with a political movement. We have to address it politically, and that's hugely important.
So you want to address it in the country then?
I do want to say, we can, well, everywhere, yeah, because don't forget, Islamism is not a it's not an international issue. You know, some of you raised that because you've got you know, caged prisoners in this country who defend Muhammad Namazie, who goes and kills for ISIS. They called him a beautiful boy. And caged prisoners in this country promotes defensive jihad. Yeah, so in this country, this is very late. I said in my speech, you've got Islamists killing people in Bangladesh, you've got them putting UK-based bloggers on death lists. So this is an international movement. In the same way that our, the people fighting Islamists in Pakistan, in Bangladesh, in Egypt, in Algeria, are part of our movement, and we are part of theirs, it's a very internationally linked movement, and we need to help each other and show real solidarity with that. The problem is, though, that I think what's happened is, because of identity politics, it's become such that only Islam and Islamism seem to matter, and not, you know, people. And I think that's fundamentally a problem, because the minute you talk about someone being stoned to death, you know, you see people glazing over. Oh, but that's not Islam. Well, come out and oppose stoning to death. I'm not saying you don't, yeah. But I'm saying that there is a thing. There's only, you know, only certain cases are defended, you know. Raif Badawi, because he criticized religion. Have you come out to defend him, for example? Good. Yeah, that's what we need to do, yeah? As well as we should be defending Islamists who are in Guantanamo, because that's just inhuman. The years and the sort of abuses that are taking place there. Fine. But what I'm saying is that when it becomes a question of identity, we fail to see each other's humanity. And, you know, it's because, you know, the problem is every time we have a discussion, we either have to hear how great Islam is, fine, it's great, but it is killing people under a banner of a political movement. It is the banner of Islamism, whether you like it or not. You know, you've got ISIS, Islamic regime, Taliban, the Mujahideen, Al-Shabaab, they are all saying that they are speaking in the name of Islam. Real Islam, not real Islam, we might disagree on that. But if we are going to live in a world where we can actually breathe, all of us, and not be afraid, we've got to get rid of the Islamists. That's my opinion. And not just the Islamists, we've got to get rid of the Jewish right, the Christian right, the Hindu right, the religious right. This is a battle between all of us who are secularists, who are free thinkers, whether we're religious or not, who think that religion is our right, but as a private matter. I think atheism is my right, but as a private matter. And if we can agree on that basic principle, that we have a right to think what we want, but are we going to work together against Islamism? But that's only if we think Islamism is a problem. I'm not sure if we agree on that. And I think
a lot of the debate is, you know, the defense of minority rights and, you know, you're offending me, this is culture, not religion. All of this sort of creates this, you know, throws mud into the air when our fight should be against the Islamists, and it is a fight of all of us, I think, you know. And one that is, I think, a matter of life and death. There, truly, many, many people are no longer safe, all, including in Britain. And so it's something that we all need to work on together. I think I'll say, because you're so lovely and you've been keeping your hand up. Is there anybody else after that? Maybe we can, two more, and then can we end it there? Is that okay, anybody else? Yeah? Okay.
I like the point that you just made a few minutes ago, the fact that we need to tackle the issue of extremism in every religion,
yeah,
and bring it back to the point that you raised about killings in the name of Islam. There's killings in the name of Christianity, there's killings in the name of Judaism, what's happening in Palestine, you know, in the past, and still happening now to the KKK. You know, these things do happen, and these are the extremists killing and slaughtering people in the name of religion, when in reality their acts shouldn't be justified with the religion, you know. And
I'll just wrap up if that's okay.
Go ahead. Yeah, I think as everyone was talking today, I kept thinking about like the situation in Syria and the Syrian refugees. I think everyone here is in agreement that the situation is terrible and people have been like defending them so much. But I think what I want to say is that no one in this room, no one in this world, in fact, can like tell us what Islam is or Christianity is. No one could, because these things are like open to subjective interpretation at the end of the day. But the thing that's happening as well, which is factual, that people are dying. People are dying. Syrian refugees that everyone talks about in this room are dying because of a political ideology under the guise of Islam. But that's factual. I really just want people to remember that. I really do.
Final comment.
Yeah, final comment.
I'm actually very happy that I was here today and I witnessed this, and I'm very glad you are as well. I think it was an amazing opportunity for me to listen to you, all your criticism and all your points, and I think you are the ones who should recognize those politicians in your group. They are the ones who do not let this discussion happen. They are the ones who are depicting your identity as citizens in this country. And I think you should be aware, and it's your job to put pressure, and everyone's job to put pressure on those activists so that we can discuss anything you want and such big issue, which is so important for everybody, but in a calm way, like this. That's my opinion.
I just want to make a few points, if that's okay, before we go. One is that killing happens in all political movements that use religion as a banner. And I said that, the Hindu right, Christian right, Jewish right. If there's a difference, if Britain First hasn't killed as many people as Islamists, in my opinion, it's only because they don't have the power. They would do exactly the same thing. And we've got examples of the Spanish Inquisition, the witch burnings, all of that, that was done in the name of Christianity. But having said that, today, the religious right that has the most power, that has state power, is Islamism. And for me, I come from a Muslim background. So it is my fight, more than anything else. And so the question I have is, why can we not just speak about Islam and Islamism without always being told about what about this, what about that, what about this? I know, everything's bad. U.S.-led militarism is disgusting. To me, it is the other side of the religious right. They feed off each other, they help them with food, and they make the world a bleak place for everyone. But can I please also focus on Islamism, because that's where most of my death threats have come from. Can I also please say that I agree that there is a distinction between Islamism and Islam, but can I also please criticize Islam as well? I need to. I want to. In the same way that you come here and eloquently defend your religion, I would like to make fun of it. I would like to criticize it. It's an idea. It's an idea that we should be open to. Just as you are free to criticize and make fun of me as my ideas, communism, it's a ridiculous idea for many people. Fine, say it. I won't call you a communist vote because that's part of this discussion. Make fun of me as an atheist, talk about atheists going to hell and whatever, fine. Some might call it hate speech. I say I don't care, just let's speak because that's where we're going to go forward.
The other thing is, I want to say that the only way we're going to move forward is if ideas and if far-right movements are not as important as people. If we are constantly worried about offense, don't offend me, don't do this, don't talk about Islamism. If you talk about Islamism, you have to also talk about, you know, the Israeli state's occupation of Palestine. You also have to talk about U.S. militarism. Don't talk about Islam unless you talk about all religions, and on, you know, if this becomes the discussion, we're not going to get anywhere. So let's agree to even bash each other's ideas, but to work together on fighting the religious right in all its forms, and to say, in my opinion, I think the key is to say, no idea is sacred, no idea is off limits, but human beings for me are sacred. So I can criticize your opinion as you can criticize mine. I'm not disrespecting you, because I might disrespect ideas I don't like. But in all of this, we need to respect human beings. And I think if our politics comes with human beings at the center, we can actually together make a huge challenge to Islamism. Thank you anyway for listening to me, and thank you for your contribution.